been doing a lot of turning and stuff here, working on stuff. Just want to release this video rather than a non-Friday because a viewer just bought a new mini lathe and he's trying to work on a compound. So this video is primarily focusing on helping him out and maybe some other people on how to fix and correct and make the compound actually a compound. But following up on the last video on the lubricants and anchor lube, I hope everybody watched the very end of that video because that's where I summarize everything and really make the point about it versus any other lube or whatever. I did get feedback. The Anchor Lube people, the company, actually watched the video all the way through and sent me a nice email about it. So yeah, she said the same thing. Hopes, thanks for spending the time and the effort. Hopes everybody watches the entire video all the way to the end. But made just a few comments on the non-toxic aspect of the product. The product was formulated decades before anyone cared about toxicity. Of course, now it's the main focus or whatever. So talking about inhaling, I'd rather inhale water vapor than toxic fumes. And they're talking about it's just as important for the home hobbyist as the factory that I had mentioned. Accidental splattering is also a consideration. No major worries about getting it in your eyes or mouth. And I was thinking about that, going, yeah, there's some job sites, I know my dad's on, where you had to drill up. And so if you're using something else, it can get in your eyes or your mouth. So I guess you can drink it. I don't know. Performance, it does surprise me I'm not getting a better result as Tap Magic. Well, I did say in the video I got the same. They're saying Anchor Lube has superior lubricity or whatever and coolant properties. What else did they go on to say? So, and I've been using it here for a lot of stuff, and it's working out great. So I'm switching away from motor oil for now. I haven't seen anything bad about it at all. Might be getting some stuff better, but if it's protecting my tools, which are expensive, then yeah, I'm definitely using it. FYI, two major benefits cannot be shown on a review. Anchor Lube substantially increases tool life. The most frequent feedback we get from our many loyal customers are its superior performance on stainless and exotic metals. And I do remember on their website, they do say it's better on exotic stuff, the hard stuff. So I haven't used it on that. I haven't seen anybody use it on exotic, you know, hard stainless or whatever. So that'll be fun to try. I did use it boring aluminum, and I got a better result than A9. So benefit increased tool life. There are drill manufacturers that actually send a small bottle of Anchor Lube with their drill bits. One other point, Anchor Lube stays on the tool, and that's what I was saying, it doesn't drip in your eyes. So, we are a small company with a corresponding small advertising budget, so we greatly value the exposure that you and other industrial YouTube channels have given us. We have seen a tremendous increase in requests for samples, and a great response from those who have tried it. So, alright, I just wanted to say that, and then here's the video on the compound. Working with the compound on the mini lathe is a very difficult thing to get nice. So, like I said in many videos, if the compound isn't tight, you don't have a lathe. So, in what I learned starting with my compound, which was a complete wreck, was like I said in the beginning, a machinist grabbed the compound and he just tilted it this way, and the gap here was moving all over the place. And that's when he said, Dave, you don't have a lathe, you aren't going to be able to turn squat until this does not move. Especially when you're trying to part, you're going to get chatter and a half because this is all moving here. So the first thing that I did was your Gibbs screws are here. You've got three Gibbs screws. And I'm looking at the Gibb itself, and what they did was, if you look face on at the Gibb here, my first lathe had one hole. The second lathe, they drilled three holes for the Gibb screws. Now you only need one, and the reason for it is when you're sliding this way, if you don't have anything that hangs onto the Gibb's going to stay put, or eventually it's going to fall out. So one Gibb screw in a hole makes the Gibb travel with the compound as you slide. So that's necessary. But the problem that I saw, one, is the Gibb screw was square. They have it, it looks like that. And being this guy, when you think about it, you're pushing, this is going to tilt, and it also needs to be able to slide up and down. So having a square Gibb screw, the edge right there is the only part that's digging in, and it's just going to keep digging into the metal and not allow it to slide. So the first thing I did was I took it to the grinder, and the best I could, I made it into a ball. So now I know it can slide or whatever. The second problem is the hole they drilled was with a drill bit. So you're going into a hole that looks like that. It's got the point to the drill bit. It's going to stay in the same spot. It's not going to allow this Gibb to tilt or move. So what I did was I just flipped the Gibb over to the other side where there wasn't anything. And if you don't have a mill, I don't know how you're going to do it. You could do it with a file. But I wound up just cutting a groove into it, like that, so to speak. So now I had something that a ball goes into a groove, it can slide up and down, and it hangs onto the thing so it doesn't slide right out of the compound. That right there, doing that and the groove, made a serious major difference in how much play there was in this thing. Now to get into lapping, there's a lot of different things. I used an automotive product because it's all I had that was rough. Kind of fine, but it was still rougher than I wanted. It's for lapping valves. You get it from Napa Automotive, different places. Put that in there, and I just use my hand, and you just run this sucker back and forth. Now the important places are when this tightens, it's going to pivot. So right here is going to contact, and here's going to contact, and then the surface. So those are the places that you need to make sure are really nice and lapped smooth. This side, it's just metal on metal. So all you do is just examine the surface. You might run some light sandpaper or something over it to get rid of any burrs, smooth it out a little bit before you start doing this. I actually put lapping compound on both sides. And you got to be careful not to tilt this thing while you're going back and forth, because now you're going to wind up with a Gibb that's, so to speak, shaped like that. So it's got to be parallel. And I did get a comment. There's a diamond lapping compound, a diamond paste that's on Amazon for $20. They give you like five or six different grits, and it's, and I wish I would have known that, because I would have used that stuff for lapping. But that's primarily what I did, and it does take time. More you use it after you kind of got it there, the more you use the lathe going back and forth, the smoother it gets, and you'll bring the Gibbs in. On adjusting the Gibbs, I think a lot of people don't get it, but they're using the Allen wrench this way, and if you turn it slightly, you're turning it like at a 1-to-1 ratio. I'm using the Allen wrench this way. Now, when you push it, you've got, think about it, there's different angles, and I'm actually using a very long Allen wrench. So now, if I move it just a hair, this is moving even less. And tenths of a thou count the difference between this thing moving and locked up. So the longer the handle you get, you now can really fine tune this thing. And the other thing I want to say with this is go get Loctite. This Gibbs screw is sloppy this way, and you move it and it just does not stay put when you're trying to play with that tight of tolerance. Put Loctite non-permanent thread locker on here. Take the Gibbs screw out, put it on there, run it in there, clean up the face, walk away. Once it sets up, run it in to approximately where you need it, then put the stuff on and walk away. Once it sets up, now you can easily just slightly move it and it stays put. You can put the nut on there if you want. I just kind of hand tightened them after I had this thing set up, and they're just there kind of for looks. I think I may have put a crescent wrench on them and just barely knock them in there so that I can easily adjust this over time and I don't have to worry about this nut becoming a problem. Loctite, definitely do that. That makes a big difference on adjustment and keeping them where they're supposed to be, because you can adjust this a bunch of times and the Loctite still keeps a good amount of friction on this screw and keeps it where it's supposed to be. So I think that's about all I can say on playing with these. I've seen a lot of people buy the LMS, they buy brass, they made their own. I'm using the stock one, and it seems to be just fine on both lathes once you do this kind of mod to them. I don't think there's anything else you need to say on it other than I did use grease in the beginning. The grease somehow starts setting up, getting thick, and it makes it harder to move. So I'm only using like motor oil nowadays in here. I had to take it apart, completely clean it down, redo it with motor oil. Moves nice and easy, and it's not locking up or getting thick anymore. There's probably a bunch of other stuff, whey lube and expensive things that you can get and use, which is fine. Everybody keeps saying you need to use something that's really sticky, that it stays on the surface. I don't know, but if everybody says that, it's probably true. I don't think I want anything sticky because it's going to add friction, but that's just my opinion on it. So good luck on working with this. If you've got any questions, my email is in the splash screen at the end, and I will be all too happy to help you out in any which way I can. There we go. One other thing I didn't mention in this that is really important. Well, I did say, gotta be careful with your hand when you're lapping this thing, because if you're constantly tilting, which I know is happening, you're not really gonna get a smooth lead screw or a screw up. A parallel Gibb, you're going to be affecting it. So what I would do would be to put the lapping compound in there, tighten these down pretty good so it's pretty stiff to move. But there is a one of the videos I showed it, somebody took a PVC cap, end cap, and they cut a groove in it like this, and they made a thing here, whatever, so you can put this in the drill. This now can go on the handle. So now you can go all kinds of different angles and you're not affecting the compound at all. You're using the lead screw to make this go back and forth with a drill, cordless drill or whatever you want to do. So now you've eliminated any human error here with your hand. And being real tight, it's not going to take very many tries here to really smooth this thing out and get it absolutely parallel and flat. So get the PVC cap, hog it out, real easy to do with a file or something, put it on the handle, and run this thing full length. So you're going from at least corner, and this is coming all the way back to the corner of the base. So now you're doing full sweeps of it. You're lapping the entire length of the lead screw. These are tight. Once you kind of do it quite a few times, Then you can take this off and move it by hand and see how stiff it is. You may want to tighten these up a little bit more because you got to keep these all equal pressure. If you have the center one tighter than the outer ones, you're going to wind up lapping it like that because the center one is pushing it in, and so the surface is going to be off. So this is tough right here. And again, that's why you use a very long handle. You can feel it better, the mechanical advantages and how tight you're getting these. So this would be how I would lap this thing. Take four. This is a hard one to do, but hopefully I get it right this time. A lot of people do not understand, and I now get it after doing and reviewing this video over and over again. A lot of people don't understand what the Harbor Freight compound friction reducing washer does. So what I'm going to do is try to explain the problem with the existing design and possible ways that you can improve it or remove the problem. So what you have on the compound is you have your lead screw. Threads are over here. And if you look under the compound or you've taken it apart, you'll see that there is this collar machined into it. Draw it nice and straight this time. Okay, so you got the shaft with the collar built in there going all the way around. I haven't really checked the compound out, but I'm pretty sure it just sits here and comes across, and you're supposed to be flush with the end. Because the collar, the dial with all the numbers on it, sits here and it's rubs up against this base piece, whatever you call it. I don't know what you want to call it, but this is the guy that's bolted on. There's a little recess in it because there's this socket head bolt that just screws straight into the compound to hold this in place. So the gap here is zero. Now, on the dial itself, it sits here, and ideally you would like a gap here so it doesn't rub on this base piece and stays put. The gap stays put. So you have the dial sitting here with all the wonderful numbers on it, and the shaft comes all the way out. I know they're different from lathe to lathe, but I'll just say it's flush here. They put a washer on here from the factory, and then your knob, however you want to draw it, is sitting in here. And they've got a socket head here that goes all the way through into the threads here. So what happens is, for this to turn the shaft, the screw has to push this all the way down against the washer, all the way against the end here of the lead screw, and clamp it. Fine and dandy, but the problem is you have play. There's a gap here, and say there's no gap here. The problem is the entire lead screw can move. You can either move this gap to here or move the gap over here. So that's the initial problem. I think this is reverse threads, I'm not sure, but there is one direction where if you're pushing or pulling the compound, whichever way, one direction is going to move the lead screw this way, closing this gap and opening this up. So now you have no friction. But when you turn the knob the other way, now the lead screw wants to go this way, and whichever way the compound wants to go, this gap closes up and this gap opens up. Now you have friction here. And in other videos I show that there's this little spring clip that sits on the lead screw shaft here, whose job it is to hold the dial in place so it doesn't really want to do this. But you can also spin the dial if you want to reset it to zero, mark, you know, the little tick mark on this, or you want to set it to a specific number. So the problem with this that I've seen on both my lathes is that it allows this thing to cock this way. So now as you turn the knob, you've got just the corner is scraping the base all the way around, and usually it's wobbling, so you get all kinds of weird stuff going on. So there's a few ways that you can fix this. One, you can probably invent something where you can tap and thread this and come up with some little doohidget that keeps this pushed up against the base piece here. That would prevent this guy from doing this number when you crank the handle. That's one method. The second method was, because this gap on my first lathe, when I made this was a long time ago, just got the lathe, seeing the problem, trying to come up with a solution to get rid of that. So first thing that popped my mind was remachine this, because this gap was too small. So I made a part that looks like this. That's pretty bad, but, and the shaft is slightly bigger, right? Yeah, it was slightly bigger than the shaft. So what happens is it allows this collar, because the collar's now in here, the dial is in here, it allowed me to pull the dial back more while this screw clamped this part, because the screw goes right through here, clamps this whole thing to the lead screw. So now when you turn this, you got the forces here and it turns the lead screw, but the dial is still independent, it's moved back more, and it allowed me to put a washer in here. And I already had some very, very thin, there were a few thousand thick brass washers to put in here. And the nice thing is, if you look at the end of it, you got the shaft, but the washers that I had kind of a bigger hole, and they weren't that big and OD, so they kind of went from here to here. So I didn't have the full friction here, and it just smoothed this whole thing out. I still have a little play. I could have messed with the depth here more to tighten it up more, but it did the job for me at the time. So that's one way to do it, and making a washer, thin washer, is really easy. I've learned the tricks later on. What you do is, on your chuck, put a steel ruler in here. Hold it with your hands, put a steel ruler that's got nice parallel edges, anything, up against the chuck. Take your tool, your cutoff tool, parting tool or whatever, you can take it more into the center and you push it all the way up against this, and now you can square it up. Because you can see the gaps here really easy. And now that you've got it really square, the next thing you do is you've got your chuck and you put your part in here. Now you can use brass, Delrin, nylon, Teflon. I would prefer Teflon. And again, you don't want a huge OD. You want just a fair amount that it's going to cover an area in here. Put it in here, face it off. You know your tool, or take your parting tool and measure the thickness of it. And let's say it's 10 thousandths. So you know you got a 10 thousandths tool. Come in, you can use a feeler gauge, eyeball, whatever. Bring it in until you just touch the face of your material here that's been faced off. Back your tool out, go in 10 thousandths. Now you know you're flush with the face. If you want a 5 thousandths washer, go in 5 thousandths more, part it off, and you got it. So it's real easy to make washers. I've made some 2 and 3 thousandths thick, which are like paper when you touch them. But so you have to put a washer in here so that you keep this gap here as this thing does this number. So that's my 2 cents, and I think that's why people don't understand it, because they don't realize I did a washer in here. Without it, you still can move back and forth, even all you did was just move the dial back and make a bigger gap. So I see people doing thrust bearings, and that one kind of gets me. I just finished watching a YouTube video on a guy that installed a thrust bearing in here, but I don't think he gave the true picture or the details on what he did. Because the ending looked nice, but I'm going, wait a minute. Thrust bearing is going to have a thickness. There's two types. There's the ball bearing type, and there's the needle bearing type. And my preference would be I want to use the needle bearings, larger surface area. I don't know. Either one, ball or needle, is going to keep this thing from rocking like this. It'll keep it, the gap, even all the way over. But you're going to wind up trying to put a thick item in a teeny hole. So what he showed in there is you have to, and he had a different, he had a Grizzly, so it's different setup than this, but on this lathe, you'd either have to hog this out, bore it out, or bore out this side. So what I'm thinking is, all right, I'll just show for argument's sake or whatever for this video. Let's bore this side out. Now, to do it right, you've got to know the exact thickness of the thrust bearing, and you got to know exactly how much play is in here. Because you got to bore this right on the money to a thousandth if you want, or less, a little more than a thousandth to give a little bit of play. But you got to be right on the money with this to sit this thing in there so that the balls are sitting in here and holding this gap and keeping this gap at zero. So that's kind of a trick to do. I'm amazed on it, but so I see a lot of people doing these thrust bearings, but I'm going, wow, nobody really tells you. I think you can see what I'm talking about, what you got to do to get the play out of this. But in the end of the video, he puts the thing all together, bolts this down, because you clamp it down, and then he's moving the knob and he says, wow, I don't feel any play, any backlash in this. And I'm thinking, really? So somehow doing that got rid of the backlash in the nut to the lead screw? Because you're always going to have play in this unless you do, what are they, backlash-free bearings or whatever, some fancy stuff that you can do. But, so this is kind of how this works to get rid of this friction, and my idea, or not ideas, my thoughts on using thrust bearings and what you have to deal with. I think just doing a washer here without even this part, if you can get something thin enough, you can make almost anything you want, would work perfect. I happen to do this and the washer to get it out. And I've got two lathes, and I checked both compounds, and I checked both saddle handles to see what the backlash is in it. And one of them, there's 7 thousandths, because you can look at the dial and you move it until it starts, you feel it hit, and then you back it up and see what the next number is when it hits. One of them had 7, another had 10, another had 4, another had 20. So these things are all over the place. They're mass produced. So in the print that you download on this, I said this is supposed to be 15 thousandths, but I'd start deeper, put it together, see where you're at, and then face it down a little bit more, see where you're at, because I know they're all different in dimensions. They're mass produced again. So I hope this kind of explained this whole thing and what I did and why I did it. And I hope it helps somebody, or somebody comes up with a neat little idea on some gizmo here that gets rid of all of this, let me know.